Good morning and welcome to IBC. Join with us today as we reflect on the most important thing in life, which is knowing Jesus. Please stand as we sing the hymn. Seats.
Good morning to all of you here present and all those at home. There's still some people that are following the service from home. This morning we have Larry McCrary, who will be taking the Word of God, or bringing it to us, better said. He's done so many times before, so I don't think there's much introduction to be made. Just a quick word on an update on Pastor Tim. He had a biopsy on Friday. It went well. The doctors are pleased so far and are hoping that the concerns that seem to be there might not be there at all. So he's just taken a couple of days rest, and that's the reason he's not here today. So let's remember him in prayer as well. So let's pray. Let's bring our hearts and souls to our God. Lord, we thank you for this day. Thank you for being able to be here and bring our souls to bless you and to remember all your mercies toward us. As we sang, the fount of every blessing and every mercy. And we want, as the psalmist to do, to get our soul going and get ourselves blessing you and recognizing your worth and recognizing your work in our lives. Lord, at the material level, thank you for all the blessings and mercies, for all your goodness. At the spiritual level, we can think of many. We can sit back and slow down from a busy day, busy week, and simply remember. And Lord, as we remember, we think of the greatest blessing and the greatest mercy that you've taken our lives out of the pit. You have taken us from being enemies of our God to being reconciled and brought into the sonship of your people and of your family. We thank you for that. Lord, as we sit now and listen to your word and we pray for Larry as he brings it to us, Lord, it may be an encouragement to us. It may be a teaching. It may be a word of correction. Lord, that we may go out of here today knowing you a little better, Lord, and being encouraged through your word in our lives. Lord, we pray for Pastor Tim as well, that you will give him peace in these circumstances, you give him rest and he may recover soon and well. In the name of our Lord Jesus, amen.
right. Today's scripture reading comes from Ephesians 2, 4 through 10. If you're following in the Black Bibles, it's page 976. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them.
Please stand once again as we sing songs to our God.
Who brings the power of sin and darkness?
take your seats.
Good morning, my name is Larry McCrary, and I really think that it's one thing to get prepared to preach and to bring the word, and there's the nervousness of all of that, but it's really one of the most nervous things is actually how do you get your face mask off and keep the microphone on and not tear off your glasses. So anyway, I think I made it through the first part. The second part always for me is maybe how do I work the slideshow, because Tim does an excellent job with that. And so just have a lot of grace, since that'll be a theme today on me on this, because normally we do not get along very well. Okay. So, but good morning. I did text with Pastor Tim yesterday, and he sends his greetings. He is doing well and is in great spirits. And so continue to pray for him. It sounds like the news is really good. And so we want to continue to pray for that and lift him up during this time. He did announce, you know, I told him, I said, stop working. It was Saturday evening. And I said, stop working. He was giving me a couple of announcements to make sure that I just wanted to pass along. So I do want to mention those real quickly. And you may have seen the slide show said winter clothing drive, collecting all kinds of winter clothing to help families in our church. Please donate only good condition, clean winter clothing, and we'll receive clothing up until October 24th. So he did not say July, he said October. Right, my bad. And then next Sunday is the 60th anniversary. And that's a pretty big deal for a church being able to be here 60 years, big anniversary, special worship service, then anniversary cake and coffee between the services. Be sure to reserve a seat. I know for my family, Susan and I, and our kids are grown and gone, and they grew up here but 20 years ago, and so when the church was 40 years old. And for a church, and I've been in this kind of world for a long time, to be strong and healthy after 60 years is such a blessing from the Lord, and we're very thankful for Emmanuel and their ministry over the years here in Madrid. So that's a couple of announcements. I want to try to get started here now with my slideshow, see if it works. I told you, I jinxed it. Here we go. Oh, you know what? You've got to turn the thing on. I'm really doing this to help you, everyone, know that anybody can run a slideshow. I can. I want to read the first verses of our scripture this morning. And this passage, when he asked me to preach on Philippians chapter 3, I was just super excited about it, because Philippians is probably my favorite book in the Bible. And so I love the book. I love Paul's writing and his work. And a lot of my job, my day job, is working and teaching often churches all over the world, but mostly in the United States, oddly enough, and helping them do missions well, for lack of a better word. And so this chapter of Philippians is just so powerful as you look at it as your life as a Christ follower. So I'm going to read the first few verses of the scripture for this morning, and then the other part will be a little bit later on. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs, look out for the evildoers, look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for how rich it is in our lives. I pray that it will guide us this morning. It will instruct us this morning. And for some of us, it will set us free. And Lord, help us to know you, not just intellectually, academically, Lord, but to know you our entire self. And Lord, we ask your blessing upon this. I pray that every word that I say will give you glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. So our verses this morning really represent some of the deepest themes of what is called New Testament theology. The passages that we're looking at this morning focuses on the idea that even the most admirable human privileges, our greatest achievements, fall short of God's requirements for acquittal in the final judgment and what he did on the cross provided the only means in which people can be rescued from this plight. Knowing Jesus and nothing more is our only path to salvation. It is his grace that gives us life. It sustains us, and therefore we can rejoice. This week, as I've been praying and thinking and researching and writing out this passage, I was talking to a friend of mine who is a pastor in Chicago, and he sent me this video clip, and you may have seen it. It's gotten a lot of hits, and I'm not going to show it today, so you can Google it later on, but it's from Alistair Begg, and it's about the thief on the cross. And it's a short clip, and so again, feel free. It's like 3 minutes long. It's worth just listening to him because he can do it so much better. But he talks about how do you answer this question. And often in circles when we talk about people that may be not believers and we ask them a question, suppose that you were to die today and stand before God and he were to say to you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? And he talks about the thief on the cross and the thief that asked Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus replied, today you will be with me in paradise. But why, Alistair was saying, but how? The only answer he could give was Jesus told him that he would be there. It was nothing that he had done. And the truth is, if we are trying to answer that question with, well, I did this, I was a good person, I, it will always, always fall short. So often in our life, as pride and arrogance can creep in because, you know, we do some good things. We may participate in ministries. We may be, you know, working as pastors, as missionaries, or we're actually handing out food to people that are hungry. We're taking care of the sick. We're doing a lot of good things. But if we start believing, even if it's ever so small, that what we have done has actually helped us, helped our case for getting into heaven, then it's wrong. Most of us would rarely verbalize this, but somehow, some way, we think maybe if our works helps, it helps us out. But a key doctrine of our faith is there's nothing that I can do, but it's rather than what has been done for me. Jesus plus nothing else sustains us and saves us. The church at Philippi meant a great deal to Paul. And you may recall in Acts chapter 16, when Paul wanted to go to Asia, and it was, you know, on the subtitle would say the Macedonian call. And so when Paul wanted to go to Asia, he had this, you know, he wanted to go, and the Spirit said no. And he tried again, and the Spirit said no. And then he tried a third time, and the Spirit's like, go to Macedonia. And he redirected him to Macedonia. And his very first stop on the missionary journey was the city of Philippi. And it was here where he goes to the riverbank, as he was much accustomed to going, and he addresses a group of Jewish women with the good news of the gospel. And Lydia, one of the women, receives the gospel. She becomes a believer, and she actually invited Paul and his companions to her household so that he could share faith with her entire household. And guess what? Her entire household became believers. And then this demon-possessed girl is set free through the power of Jesus. Well, her owners did not really like that. And it was not helpful for their business, and their complaints to the local authorities landed Paul and his companions into jail. And then in jail, they were able to interact with the jailer who witnessed them not running away when they could have, and the jailer becomes a believer. And I say all of this, when you look at that in Acts chapter 16, it sets the context for Philippians because Acts chapter 16 shows the core group of the Philippian church. And as later as Paul traveled onward and he got into more trouble with authorities for preaching the gospel, this young church at Philippi ministered to Paul. They actually sent one of their members, Epaphroditus, with a gift to minister to Paul. And Epaphroditus actually stays a while and ministers alongside of Paul. And we just read about him in chapter 2. And Paul says, even in his introduction in Philippians, he says, every time I remember you, I thank God for the partnership of the gospel from the very first day until now. He loved this church. He cared about this church. He was connected to members there. And later in the book of Philippians, Paul writes in 4:1, therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I long and I love and long for, you are my joy, my crown. Stand firm in the Lord. He had this affection for the church of Philippi. I've had the opportunity over the years, around 1990, I became what is called a church planter. I would start churches and started doing so in the United States. And one church in particular that we started, I pastored there for 5 or 6 years after we started it. And you know, I was there in the dreaming phase, the infancy phase, the childhood, the rebellious teenage years, you know, all of those phases. But my heart was so connected to the church when we left and we moved on because it meant so much to me. And so that's even just a little small glimpse of how much Paul must have felt to this church of Philippi. He had a special connection. He had a special place in his heart. And so when we get to the third chapter, and what we're looking at today, Paul starts off by saying, finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble for me, and it's safe for you. And he's transitioning, if you remember in chapter 2, he's transitioning from talking about Timothy and Epaphroditus, and he returns to his theme of rejoicing in the Lord, and he needs to address a concern that is looming for the church at Philippi. And remember, he's writing this while he's in prison, you know, yet he's talking about joy. He's talking about rejoicing. That's his theme. And he knows what is at stake, though. He had no doubt that he had heard about a group of Judaizers that who were making their way, making their rounds through the region. And these people had invaded the churches in Galatia, and they would make their way to Philippi. He knew it. He saw it coming, and he wanted to write this letter to warn them. And because he cared deeply about the church of Philippi, he was hoping to help them avoid the things that could happen when a church starts believing in something else. Listen to what Paul writes early on in Galatians 1:6. Well, first, so the problem was actually with what we call the Judaizers. And the gospel of the Judaizers mixed this notion that our faith in Christ, salvation, with the idea that all the people that wanted to belong to God's people must accept also the yoke of Jewish law. Gentiles believers, in their view as Judaizers, had to become a Jew in order to be saved. They added to the gospel. And listen to what Paul writes in Galatians 1:6. I'm astonished that you're so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion or trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. And so when we come to the third chapter of Philippians, his tone changes. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. I mean, he uses some powerful name, powerful imagery. And that would emphasize his concern for what was happening. So look, I mean, dogs. I mean, now here, you know, in Madrid, you know, most of the time, I'm not much of a dog person, okay? I'll just be honest and transparent. But most of the time, the dogs are kind of cute, right? And they're on leashes, so I feel kind of safe with that. You know, I'm a runner, and so often when I run here, I feel okay because most dogs are on the leash. When I run in other parts of the world and in my home country in the United States, that may or may not happen, and there's something that must have happened a long time ago because I really dislike them. But anyway, I digress. He says, watch out for the dogs, but he's not talking about the cute little poodles. He's talking like street dogs, coyote-like scavengers who feed on roadkill and filth and garbage. And they were vivid images of the unclean. So for the Jews, a dog was the perfect metaphor for those who did not keep Israel's dietary laws. and thus a powerful metaphor for Gentiles and lapsed Jews, you dogs. That's what we could call them, right? We see that. But here in Philippians, by warning Christians, look out for the dogs, Paul reversed the image, charging that the Judaizers were unclean dogs who stood outside of the covenant's blessing. Powerful. And then he says evildoers. The second name he calls, look out for the evildoers. It's likewise this barbed irony because it is a pun on the Judaizers' claim to be doing the works of the law. They were very, we do the works of the law. And the works of the law was this pious slogan used to distinguish a Jew from a Gentile, or the observant Jew from being non-observant. By Paul calling the Judaizers evildoers, Paul was saying that rather than doing the works of the law, they were literally evil workers. Turns it around. The irony for the Judaizers was that all of their intentions to do the works of the law made them evil workers and therefore spiritual Gentiles, dogs. And finally, mutilate the flesh. The third name he used to describe them, look out for those who mutilate the flesh, is particularly scathing because it's a wordplay in a way. It's mutilate in Greek is katome, which is a sarcastic play on the word for circumcision, peritome. Thus, he concludes, circumcision, their greatest source of pride, is interpreted by the apostle as mutilation, a sure sign that they have no part in God's people at all. Powerful words. But the truth is in verse 3 about circumcision when Paul writes, for we are the circumcision, church, Christ's followers. We are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Looking again at the book of Galatians, the letter to the Galatian church, it sheds some lights on this importance. And Paul is like writing, it's like you can see in verse 11, he's going, see what large letters I use when I write with my own hand. He was telling the Galatian church, I'm serious about this. Big letters, all caps. Those who want to impress people, verse 12, by means of the flesh are trying to compel you to be circumcised. The only reason they do this is to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. Not even those who are circumcised keep the law, yet they want you to be circumcised that they may boast about your circumcision in the flesh. May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. What counts, Paul writes, is the new creation. There's nothing you can do, nothing you can add to the gospel. It is complete. And as Christ's followers in the church, in this church, we have the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us in worship. What does it mean that we Christians are the circumcision? Even when the circumcision was one of God's laws for his people, it had more to do with the heart than the body. Kent Hughes, in his excellent commentary on the book of Philippians by the same title, writes, we are circumcised not because of something we do with our bodies, but because of what God has done in our hearts. We worship not because we come to church, but because the Spirit of God has come to us. We hope not because we hold on to Christ, but because he holds on to us. The worship team earlier saying how deep the Father's love for us, and I'm not going to try to sing that for you this morning, luckily. I actually do worse than my slideshow. But the last verse, it says, I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but I know this with all of my heart, his wounds has paid my ransom. It's nothing that we do. The second set of verses is from 4 to 6. Though I myself have confidence, you know, Paul continues writing, though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Blameless. So look at this list here, you know. He recounts the reason that if anyone else would have confidence in the flesh, I could do this. And so he lists it out. Ritual, check. Race, check. Rank, check. Tradition, check. Morality, check. Sincerity, check. Rule keeping, check. And he says, ritual, I was circumcised on the eighth day. Now that's a pretty big deal in his time. Hughes, in his commentary, says, circumcised, he was circumcised by his parents 7 days after his birth, which is the Jewish eighth day, in strict compliance with the covenant. Most significantly, this meant that he was not a proselyte from paganism. He was not a later-in-life convert. He was an insider from birth. By the way, in Genesis 17, then God said to Abraham, as for you, you must keep my covenant, you and your descendants after you, for the generations to come. This is my covenant with you and your descendants after you, the covenant you are to keep. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You are to undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and you. Verse 12 of Genesis 17, for the generations to come, every male among you who is 8 days old must be circumcised. And he speaks with an authority that none can challenge, at least of his opponents. I mean, they listed this out first. You know, their main tenet, that the expected approach to the Philippian church may have been, you need to be circumcised. You came to faith, but you also need to be circumcised. And Paul would counter this false notion by placing circumcision at the very head of the list to show that he has the right to be heard on this true significance in life. And then he says race. He's from the people of Israel. Racially, he was a pure-blooded Israelite. Israel and Israelite were kind of inside terms by which Jews referred to their own nation. Other people may call them Jews, but only they call themselves the children of Israel, and Paul was a total insider. And then there's rank. Not only was he an Israelite, but he was from the tribe of Benjamin. Benjamin was the only son born in the Promised Land, and the tribe of Benjamin was the only tribe to remain faithful to Judah and the house of David after the death of Solomon. The tribe of Benjamin went into exile with the tribe of Judah and returned from exile into Judah to resettle Jerusalem. You can read about that in Nehemiah. Benjamin remained at the core of spirituality. King Saul, Israel's first king, was a Benjaminite. And the apostle Paul, who was first called Saul, was given that name. Paul's heritage radiated this insider pride. And so we could see this. I mean, even in our own city here in Madrid, I mean, sometimes when we'll meet people and I'll ask them where they're from, and you know, some, well, I'm from Asturias, but I live here in Madrid. But people that are from Madrid say, I'm from Madrid. And my mom and dad are from Madrid, and their mom and dad from Madrid. It was an important aspect of their identity. Now, I'm from East Tennessee, and it's similar. We have this pride about our heritage. We're mountain people. We're from the mountains of East Tennessee, and our people can move to our city in Knoxville, and they can live there for 40 years, but they're really not from there, at least according to us as Knoxvillians. They're transplants. They're outsiders. I'm Knoxvillian because my parents were born there and their parents were born there. It's a difference. And Paul is emphasizing that not only am I an Israelite, but I am from the tribe of Benjamin. And then there's tradition, a Hebrew of Hebrews. Though Paul had been born outside the Holy Land in Tarsus, he was a Hebrew. His parents were Hebrews. And it also indicates he spoke Hebrew and Aramaic. And he spoke when so many of the people in what we would call the diaspora Jews, people that lived outside of Jerusalem, outside of Israel, they knew only Greek. But Paul prayed and read the scriptures in Hebrew. His parents made sure he had the best education in Jerusalem under the famous Rabbi Gamaliel. Paul was a private school insider. Also, there's morality. As to the law, a Pharisee. We know the law. Paul's ancestors were Pharisees. as he told the Sanhedrin. But Paul's Pharisee, however, Paul's Phariseeism was a matter of choice. It was a deep conviction as he voluntarily bound himself to keep hundreds of the commandments of oral law. They took the Ten Commandments and made them into hundreds. Paul was a brilliant, knowledgeable Pharisee, a heavyweight who could hold his own with anyone. Sincerity, as zeal, he says, I'm sincere. I persecuted the church. His self-appointed zeal led the way to this persecution of early Jewish Christians, early church. And when you look in Acts, in the very first part of Acts, and as the church became scattered, you could also find Paul's name, Saul at that time, someone that they were scared of because he was persecuting the early Christians. I'm sincere, Paul says. Rule-keeping, and I know how to live right. As to righteousness under the law, I'm blameless. Paul's conduct was blameless in the sense that blameless describes this exemplary way of life in accordance to the Pharisees' interpretation of the law. And it's how his peers saw him, wholly blameless. Saul of Tarsus, Paul, was blameless under the law. And what amazement, what acclaim that he can make. He was like this spiritual athlete in a category all by himself. What discipline he had. And unless we've become just a little bit overconfident that this doesn't really apply to us, you're describing things that were long ago and it's to a different church. Matt Chandler wrote a book called To Live as Christ and to Die as Gain, and he gives us an example of modern circumcision, okay? You think you have a reason to boast? I have a reason to boast all the more. I've never missed Sunday school. I've never missed a Sunday morning worship service. I would add, even during COVID, I was online for every Sunday morning service. I read my Bible every day. I've memorized the New Testament. I've shared the gospel with all of my neighbors. I've never said a cuss word except those invented for Christians to say, like dingbat or shazbot, something like that. And I don't even listen to secular music. And I've never seen a plus 18 or R-rated movie that wasn't about Jesus being crucified. You see, we can kind of do that. We can kind of just keep putting ourselves up that we're okay because we're doing this, this, and this. And after this list, he could boast about things. He says, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Paul wrote that there are three things that allow us to know Jesus more and more. Knowing Jesus comes through sharing his righteousness. Knowing Jesus comes through sharing his suffering. Knowing Jesus comes through sharing his resurrection. Knowing Jesus first, let's look at knowing Jesus comes through sharing his righteousness. But whatever gain I had, I count as loss for the sake of Christ. In other words, he's just pure-blooded Jew from birth. He came as an elite caste. He had the highest education. He was so passionate that he attacked Christians. He kept all of God's law. And if anyone had reason to trust in himself, it was Paul. But he did not trust in himself. Why? Because the most important thing in life is not being right or being honored. The most important thing in life is knowing Jesus Christ as Lord. And knowing comes through sharing his righteousness. What is righteousness? It's really just a big word to say right relationship with God. And Paul wrote this to describe sharing Jesus' righteousness. It's not something he could obtain on his own, but through grace. And he says, but I count it lost. His former accomplishment had just become just nothing to him. Not because they were bad, but they were not, because he kept him from Christ. And he had no regrets. John Calvin wrote that often when people are battling a storm, he paints this picture of people battling a storm at sea. They cast their belongings overboard to lighten the load so that they may be saved. And then afterwards, they kind of lament over the loss of all of their goods. Paul did not look back. There is no hidden longing because he will gain Christ in the final day when his goal is fully realize to die will be gain. Now take a look at this. It's a little bit different than a profit and loss sheet because these are just words and not numbers. But think of it in this way. Paul was, he wasn't really mathematically challenged because he uses kind of interesting accounting terms. His account balances, though, in a very odd way. Everything was on the credit side. You know, we watched that earlier. I mean, Jesus, ritual, race, rank, tradition, morality, sincerity, rule-keeping, all of these things we put on the profit side. However, in a flash, he struck off everything on the from the credit column and inserted it into the debt column. Christ alone stands in the credit column. And I just think that's just such a beautiful picture of what Christ has done for us. One by one, the apostle had carefully added up the individual items of merit as he looked into judgment, and they were real pluses, but in a blinding moment, they became one singular loss, and Jesus became Paul's one and only credit. The next thing I want us to look at would be knowing Jesus comes through sharing his suffering. Indeed, I count everything as lost because of the surpassing knowledge, worth of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of things, and I count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. Gaining Jesus meant losing everything for Paul. He lost his pride, his honor, his friendships, his wealth, his health, his plans. It was like a ship in the middle of the storm. He threw away the possessions, like I mentioned, and he could just weep over his loss, but he did not look back in that way, because of what he gained in knowing Jesus. Over the years, I've had the privilege, really, of traveling and talking to a lot of different Christian leaders throughout the world, probably around 30 different countries. And I've talked to many different believers in these countries who lost a lot when they actually said yes to Jesus. They lost their family, their standing in the community, their jobs, their companies. Some were marginalized. Others suffered physically and emotionally because of their faith. For Paul, to know Christ is to know his sufferings. He even compares all of that to rubbish, as to garbage, just worthless in comparison to all that he had gained. He was letting the church know that they could face suffering. They could face suffering for the sake of their faith, because suffering enables them to know him more personally. I mean, let's be honest. Well, let's start with me. I will definitely be honest here. When things are going well in this life for me, I can kind of start believing in myself. I can start thinking, okay, I've got this. But when I face hardship, when I face pain, when something hurts, when I don't feel so good, when I'm sick, it drives me to my knees. It should not be this way only when I'm facing hardship and suffering. It should just be my way of life in sickness or in health. A verse that's meant a lot to me over the years is Luke chapter 9, verse 23. He said to them all, Jesus is talking, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. And when you think of the imagery here of Jesus carrying the cross to his crucifixion and hanging on the cross with his death and all that he suffered, and he tells his disciples, hey, you need to do this daily. During the good days, during the tough days, through our suffering, we can even find joy, because our joy is not based on how we feel on the outside. It's not based on how well things are going. It's this inner sense of wellness that we only have with Christ Jesus. But look what comes next. Knowing Jesus comes through sharing his resurrection. Verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, that I may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may obtain the resurrection from the dead. And as we noted, the fellowships of sufferings, it's a literal translation, is may share in his sufferings. It's really part and partial with the power of his resurrection. They go hand in hand. It's like Good Friday and Easter. Good Friday, we remember his death. On Easter, we celebrate his resurrection. In tandem, they provide a way to knowing him more. The power of resurrection, God's power, his life-giving power that he deployed raising Christ from the dead, the power that God uses to bring about and sustain new life the Christian receives from Christ and shares with him. Conversion is, in fact, really described in the New Testament as resurrection. As Paul explained to the Ephesians, and you are dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air and the spirit which is now at work in the sons of the disobedient. We were condemned in our sinfulness. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love which he has for us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places. It's really like the symbolism of baptism. When somebody becomes a believer, they place their faith and trust in their life in Jesus Christ. In the church, we have a baptism, and we baptize by immersion as people that are believers. And the symbolism is, you know, even when a person goes under, buried in Christ in baptism, raised to walk in a newness of life. It's that symbolism. His grace saves us. His grace sustains us and keeps us in right standing. His grace gives us reason to rejoice. Is that true for you today? Is it true for me today? Has anything become more important to us than knowing Jesus? Have we somehow bought into this, you know, believing of the bad news that knowing Jesus plus something else equals my salvation? Is there anything you are trusting in along with Jesus that can make you right with God? Is it knowing Jesus plus being a good person? Is it knowing Jesus plus honoring the religion of your parents? Is it knowing Jesus plus a pain-free life? Knowing Jesus is enough for our salvation. Let's pray. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your powerful imagery that we have in the book of Philippians. And I thank you for the warning that you give to the Philippian church we adhere to today, that it's you and nothing else that gives us salvation. Lord, I pray if there's people in this room that you will open up their hearts if they've never received you and that they will come to know you in a personal way. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your grace that saved us and sustains us and gives us hope so that we may rejoice. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we respond to the message. Oh.
Yes, Lord, we declare that this is the greatest thing, to know you as our Lord and Savior. Thank you, Father, because it's that knowledge that makes us righteous. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross and to bring salvation into our lives. Father, help us to live by this knowledge. Help us as we face trials and tribulations, not only because we live in this world, but also because we choose to follow you. Thank you because you've promised to be with us in the midst of our sufferings. And Father, as we look to the day in which we will be in your presence, when we will experience fully the joy of that resurrection, help us to always bring glory and honor to you in everything that we do. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
Sunday, and see you next week.